My name is Yunus Mirza. I'm the director of the Brzezinski Institute of Global Virtual Learning here at Shenandoah University. We're really excited to welcome you all to this forum on climate change and COIL virtual exchange. The Brzezinski Institute for Global Virtual Learning mission is to collaborate with institutions of higher education around the world to explore similarities and differences in their missions and practices, to understand the challenges that they face, and to create solutions in light of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. And we have a lot of different projects going on. This one we're very excited about regarding climate change. We have three different pillars as part of our institute. We have a conference pillar, and we'll have a fall conference where we showcase and highlight our various initiatives, which include the wonderful work of Sammy and Stacy. Please save the date for October 2nd and 3rd. We invite you to come to our campus. Our second pillar is a service pillar where we work on zero hunger. And we have a MOU and relationship with Yarmouk University in Jordan, where we survey our local food banks and share best practices regarding how we can best serve our local populations in terms of food insecurity. And lastly, we have an academic pillar, which fits COIL, or Collaborative Online International Learning. And that's when two professors work in their classes to create shared modules where their students interact and contribute to the UN Sustainable Development Goals. So we're very fortunate to have some wonderful speakers here today. And we'll start first with Maria Belinska, who is the Executive Director of the US-UK Fulbright Commission. And then we'll turn it over to our friends at the AACNU. So please, Maria.
Thank you, Yunus, so much. And I just want to say how delighted I am to be with all of you today. It's absolutely wonderful to be hearing about the exchange that Sammy and Stacy have co-designed and taught together. And I was going to just say a few words of how it came to be that the US-UK Fulbright Commission was sponsoring these awards. And actually, interestingly enough, and very appropriately, it came about because of climate change and before COVID in 2019. And we were thinking about how could we bring these benefits that you get from cultural and educational exchange to students who aren't able to travel. Because after all, if you look at the statistics, whether it's the UK or the US, you have a pretty much 80% of students do not go abroad during their undergraduate course. So that was the sort of first emphasis. How could we use technology to do something really innovative and exciting? But as we, were thinking about it further, a number of other benefits became very, very clear for us, because as the only organization to be sponsoring two-way exchange between the US and the UK in both directions across the Atlantic, and we do it for every generation, collaboration and brokering relationships between institutions of higher learning is very much at the center of what we want to do. And therefore, this award also could offer that opportunity for us to, bring together institutions from across the Atlantic. And the third big benefit, as we saw it, was Yunus was just talking about the contribution to the UN Sustainability Goals. And we, as a commission, because we have this privileged position of, representing the diversity of both of our countries in our exchanges and really building a community that is representative of the very rich diversity of both the US and the UK in all its dimensions, we see this as therefore an opportunity and a responsibility to bring our community together to think about these big wicked problems that the world is facing, because it is that diversity of perspectives that's going to help us address that. And therefore we thought, what a fantastic thing if we could bring all of these goals together and think about an award that would really democratize global learning, that would bring together institutions across the Atlantic, and would also promote excellence and innovation in teaching about global challenges and in teaching virtually. So this is the we worked on all of these things. I have to say we had the original thought in 2019, but it took us a while, as you can imagine, to develop the actual program and also to find the funding to make it happen. And of course, the key thing that we realized was we didn't have the expertise to help our awardees with co-designing and co-teaching a virtual exchange. And so I was very fortunate to be introduced to Veronica and her colleague Robin at ACE then, who were actually just in the process of organizing together with John, who's here on the call, a collaborative online international learning initiative between universities in the US and Japan. And so we began to talk together, and they helped me really sort of put together the initial idea for these awards, which for the first time for us were baking into the award collaboration, because they're pairs of awards. They're not for individuals. They're for pairs of professors, pairs of institutions. So it really was a question of the right time, the right place, the right people, but without any question that I got to meet John, Veronica, and Robin at that point. And that really, then we sort of took off. And I think I should really hand over now to John to talk about how, you know, you thought about adapting COIL to this particular set of awards. And if I can just, before I do that, John, sorry, to say that in this first cohort, we had three pairs of awards that we were offering. One was focused on climate change, one on racial justice, and one on global health and pandemics. And we had 75 applicants over a competition window in the autumn of 2021, which was quite short. And it was a very onerous application process, as I'm sure Stacey and Sammy can attest to. And so it really proved to us that there was also quite a lot of interest in this model. And we're, you know, excited to be able, we're going to hopefully later this year open up the second competition for these awards. So Global Challenges Teaching Awards, over to you, John.
Great. Thank you, Maria, for that background. And Eunice and your colleagues, thank you for including us in the forum here today. Veronica Honor-Revelle is indeed with us. She's in the chat, so she may send some introductions and some comments in the chat function there, but I'll be handling the remarks a little bit here. And indeed, it was great to see the level of interest that we got in the application phase. Maria, I think actually we had more than 75. I think it was closer to 100 that ended up getting submitted. But and indeed, in the applications or any of the projects that we're involved with, we actually like to build that collaboration even at that application stage. So although they're somewhat onerous, using that word that you used there, really it helps us set the foundation for those projects to be successful, even at the application phase. It requires some collaboration within the institutions that are looking to apply, and in other cases, actually with their partners abroad as well. So just to give a little bit of kind of our background coming into this, Maria mentioned the rapid response program that we had done with Japan, some work that we had done in that space, kind of helping the higher education community adapt to the realities that came with the pandemic. Of course, the options for new and blended modes of communications became much more common since the start of the pandemic. And honestly, what impressed me was how well overall higher education managed to kind of pivot and adapt to these new realities. And of course, we've all, I'm sure many of you on this call also have learned a lot of lessons on the power and the potential, and we'll say some of the downsides of having to rely so heavily on digital tools in higher ed. And I think really time's going to tell how much the longer impact of those lessons are going to be. But one thing that I think is really clear is this digitalization of higher education is well underway, and that we now have so many more opportunities, as we're seeing here on this call. We have a very international group of folks who are joining us today for this session that didn't have to physically travel to come together. And we now are seeing we can do events such as these. And in the past, we would have been much more localized likely and really throw them open to the world and allow people to come together in ways that really we wouldn't have thought about nearly as often prior to the pandemic and this exposure that we all got to the power of these new tools. So kind of pulling back a little bit, you'll see my on my name here, it says AACNU, but when this project started, actually Veronica and I were both at the American Council on Education, ACE. And while we were there, we were more than happy to collaborate with US-UK Fulbright Commission on how we could use some of that new digitalization to bring new ideas to one of the really the flagship international education programs in the world, which is the Fulbright program. And in working with Mari and her team, it was really clear that we had a similar vision on the need to innovate how we deliver these global learning opportunities. And so we were more than happy to adapt what was then called a virtual exchange COIL transformation lab, really into a bespoke version that would serve that Fulbright community. And as Mari mentioned, serve the nature of the Fulbright community, which in the past was much more driven by individuals, and allowing individuals to apply with some institutional backing and support, and then helping match them up with other individuals around the world through a matchmaking process, which I'll talk a little bit more about later. But really, in many ways, Fulbright's been a part of COIL, Collaborative Online International Learning, since the beginning. Some people on this call will know who was at that time Professor John Rubin, who went on to found the SUNY COIL Center. The initial ideas and thoughts of COIL came out of his own Fulbright experiences that he had in Belarus once upon a time, and wanting to come up with some ways to connect the students and faculty that he'd worked with while in Belarus with the students and faculty that he knew back at SUNY Purchase College. And this was in the more than pushing 20 years ago now. And it really kind of started to plant the seeds of what became this COIL movement, which is now spread around the world. And there are many Fulbrighters around the world now who are doing some versions of COIL even before, during, or even after their Fulbrights. So we've now transitioned the Transformation Lab to AACNU, which is the American Association of Colleges and Universities, and we're now branding it as the Institute for Virtual Exchange COIL. And as Mari mentioned, we're continuing to work together and look for new ways that we can generate new opportunities, both connected with the Fulbright Commission, but also connected with other partners around the world. And Veronica may be able to add a link into the chat. If not, I'll add one in later about the current institute that we're running in collaboration with Norway, Japan, and South Korea, along with the U.S. here. So my role kind of in the lab primary was leading the faculty track of the Transformation Lab. And it was really a pleasure to work with Sammy and Stacy, as well as their supporting teams, Cara and Andre and Eunice, during this past year. And it was wonderful to watch their relationship and partnership continues to develop since we first put them together, as I mentioned, through that matchmaking process that really honestly was a bit of a blind date. We kind of brought the two of them together and tried to see if some sparks would fly in effect, you know, on a professional level, and see if they had some connections with each other and had some chemistry that they could build upon to go through this relatively intimate process of adapting their courses and really trying to create these opportunities for their students. And honestly, it was quite wonderful to see how gracefully they worked together, even as new partners, and getting through some of the early challenges that they had in developing their COIL projects to create really an engaging plan to bring together students for this online exchange and collaboration. I think some of the most exciting collaborations that we have in the COIL space are such as theirs, coming from interdisciplinary projects and really bringing their students together from different types of backgrounds. And it was wonderful to see the fruits of their hard work in the form of the Shenandoah Carter Student Project podcast projects that we'll be highlighting here today. And it's really only through such these global collaborations that we can hope to solve the big global challenges that we're all facing, such as climate change in this case. And as I'm sure they'll share, both for themselves and for their students, collaboration is definitely not an easy process. It does require work and a lot of patience, and the key word, which I'm sure they'll remember from the training, flexibility, both on the having new ideas and being open to the ideas of others and being willing to be flexible on how you deliver that. I'm sure some of that comes across with your students' projects as well. But it's really only through such collective action that we're going to be able to come together as a worldwide community to address those many challenges that we face. And I'm really excited to see how Sammy and Stacy, as well as their colleagues at Cardiff and Shenandoah, continue to build on this collaboration into the future, and to see the wonderful future work that this collaboration has hopefully inspired in your students to do in the future as well. And with that, I'll say thank you and hand it back to you, Eunice.
So thanks so much, John and Mario, for those remarks. It's wonderful to hear this story about the genesis of the project and how Mario, how you reached out to John and Veronica, how that collaboration led to this collaboration with Stacey and Sammy. And this is really helpful for me, and I think many others at different universities here in the US, where we were primarily an in-person exchange. We did study abroad We did also spring break trips, but now we're moving the last year or two into the global virtual learning space. So hearing your story is inspiring and I think a model for the rest of us. So let's go ahead and transition now to Stacy and Sammy, who are the ones who awarded this award. And they're going to present on their collaboration and how they had their students work together to create podcasts on climate change. Dr. Stacy Strobel is a professor of criminology and criminal justice here at Shenandoah University in Virginia. And she is actually a graduate of our COIL training and then joined the lab with our friends, Veronica and John. And then we'll also hear from Dr. Sammy Buzzard, who is a glaciologist and climate scientist at Cardiff University in Wales. So Stacy and Sammy, please take it away.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for being here. I'm excited that we have 30 folks that joined us. First, I'd like to just say a few thank yous because this kind of work really takes a village. You know, it sounds easy to, you know, run some assignments virtually, and yet the complexities, as Sammy and I got into them, were definitely there. You've got two different classes, two different institutions, two different countries. And so it really has taken a village. So we want to thank everybody at Fulbright, in particular Maria and Jess, who are on this call, and then the AA and CU lab trainers, John and Veronica. And then on the SU side, on our team, we had Eunice, Karen Lucas, and then we also had on the Cardiff side, Andre Duploy. Numerous people have helped us along the way. And so we thank all of those people. We are also going to be working with another professor at SU to actually clean up the podcasts technically, to get out like echoes and things like that. As we'll talk about, the students weren't necessarily audio engineers, right? So we have Professor Graham Spice of the Shenandoah Conservatory, who's going to be working to make them a lot shinier so that when we share them internationally, that will be of benefit. So we thank everybody who has been a part of this. So we're going to really focus on the collaboration itself was 7 weeks, but we're really going to focus on the culminating assignment that really was the deeper piece of it, which took the last 4 to 5 weeks of the 7 weeks that the students worked on. And this was podcasts that were done in small groups between students from both institutions. And we have one student who's here with us, Greg Van Steen. Greg, you want to just give a wave for now? He's going to, you know, in a few minutes, give us some of his impressions of being a student who participated. So you know, watch out for that. That's exciting stuff to come here. And we hope that this session, focusing on this podcast, doesn't just touch on the possibilities for doing this in a virtual exchange, but also touches on how this can be helpful for thinking through climate change, kind of making good on the SDG that the UN has on climate action potentially, but also podcasts as a pedagogy that really any classroom could hypothetically use. So this could be, you know, something that folks could consider for a variety of different learning scenarios that they find themselves in. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Sammy to kick us off on some details.
Okay, thanks, Stacey. And I should say thanks to Eunice for organizing this forum today. Again, to the Fulbright folks who made this happen, as well as John and Veronica, who got us through this process. And it's great to see lots of Shenandoah faces that I met during my trip there last year as well on this forum. So hi, and nice to see some of you again. So I was going to start today by talking a little bit about the award itself, but Mario has already covered some of that, which is great. And that will give us more time for questions at the end, which I'm sure plenty of you will have. But just to give you kind of a little bit more context, I guess, from the applicant side before we dive into what we actually did. One of the most common questions I get around this partnership is, did we, Cardiff as an institution, apply with Shenandoah? But of course, we applied all as individuals to this. So all of those between 70 to 100 people who applied did not know each other at the start. And we went through this matchmaking process as John mentioned, and I don't know what magic that they work behind the scenes, but it clearly worked really well. And the first Zoom that Stacey and I went on to, they gave us a few minutes in a breakout room just to kind of say hi and get to know each other before we confirmed we wanted to do the award. And we just talked for so long, we never actually really discussed the original question we were supposed to be talking about. And it's gone really well since then. So whatever you're doing, keep doing it. It's been wonderful. So we had that initial kind of interviews and matching process. Then we went through some quite extensive training where John and Veronica talked through all the different aspects of the COIL, many of which we were expecting. So how we were going to deal with kind of practical issues and different platforms we could use, but many of which we didn't, because even though we were lucky in terms of this COIL that we all speak the same language, there are still some slight differences between US and UK English that we came across, but different things like the term times being different, the class sizes being different, which we'll come to later. And it was really great to have John and Veronica on board to be able to guide us through those challenges. So in terms of the podcast assignment itself, this is something that I had previously run with my global climate change class, because both classes in this partnership, as with the other four who also had this award, were existing classes that we adapted for the COIL. So in the past, my students have produced podcasts in groups, and they would produce them around a different aspect of physical climate change. So my students are third year geography students here at Cardiff, and they would take topics such as Arctic sea ice or atmospheric storms, and they would produce a podcast on that. So when we came to discussing the assessment for this COIL, both Stacey and I were quite excited about the idea of doing podcasts again, but we realised we'd have to change this a bit because previously mine were very focused towards physical climate change. And while we hoped that Stacey's students would understand aspects of physical climate change from working with my students, I was also very keen that we would incorporate those kind of social and legal aspects that the Shenandoah side were such experts on into the learning of my students too. So we revised the assessment and made it into podcasts around specific locations. And so we gave the students a list of locations that Stacey and I felt were particularly important for different reasons in terms of future climate change, and the students kind of gave us their top choices. They all got assigned locations, and then they worked in mixed groups between the Cardiff and the Shenandoah students to produce those podcasts about a location that they had chosen. So Stacey, should I hand over to you to talk a little bit about the Google Classroom now? How we did this in a practical sense. Okay, maybe while Stacey sorted the screen share, I will talk for a little bit about that and allow her to unmute. But what we're seeing here at the moment is the tool that we use to kind of bring our two classes together. And because we were working in two different learning management systems, so we had kind of a Blackboard system on our side and something different on the Shenandoah side. And it turned out that actually Google Classrooms was the best kind of tool for us to meet somewhere in the middle. So all of our students were at the same level. It wasn't one lot of students having to learn someone else's system. And the, as you can kind of see here, the Google Classroom gave us kind of a nice area that was fairly straightforward and should have been fine for the students to kind of just look at and know intuitively what they had to do. And I think we both had a fairly positive experience of using that. Stacey, do you want to add anything on that part? You're muted, sorry.
Okay. Yeah, I think we really benefited from having a mutual landing page for the collaboration itself. So we each of our courses and at our institution had learning management systems. They weren't the same ones. And so it was really important, I think, especially for a big culminating assignment like this, that we were able to select something that could be mutual to all the students and, you know, didn't cost any money for them or us to utilize. And so we ended up going with Google Classrooms. And so this was great because they could actually not only see, as you see here on the screen, the sort of common narrative of what the overall objective of the assignment was. They could also upload their final product to this site. And in the end, they were listening to each other's. So it was really a nice space of mutual learning. Of course, we each had to fulfill the goals of our individual classes. So as you can imagine, a climate science class and a environmental crime class, you know, have very, very different learning outcomes because of the nature of the disciplines. And so even though we had this umbrella that you see here that encompassed what everybody was doing, we had each had modified further instructions per the class in order to meet the learning needs of the students and the programs that they are in. So I thought what we could do now is maybe talk a little bit about how we both came together and also had this specificity within our courses. So first, Sammy's going to talk a little bit about how the assignment fit into the Cardiff context.
Yes. Yeah, so as I said, this was an existing assignment for us. So that was slightly easy on my part that we had something to adapt. But the difference here was really adding in that kind of social and legal aspects to this work. A lot of our climate change course here focuses on communicating climate science, which is why we picked the podcast, and my students separate to the COIL have also been producing infographics and blogs and different ways to communicate this huge and important topic that they can take away once they graduate and have those skills. And what you can see here is an activity that we carried out to kind of give everyone the same basis as they got into that kind of mixing of these two disciplines. So this is from in my classroom at Cardiff University, and we had our students giving live presentations, and then Stacey's students at Shenandoah were on Zoom and giving presentations to our class. And within that, we'd given different groups of students very kind of small topics that they could quickly kind of give the other students a briefing on. So mine were covering physical climate change topics, kind of giving the 101 about changing melting ice in the polar regions, extreme weather events. And then Stacey's students were talking about kind of some of the legal frameworks that they investigate in their class. So that both classes got kind of a bit of a footing in the discipline of the opposite class. So in terms of that, we didn't have to really change our assignment too much at Cardiff. And by having the place-based aspect of the podcast, it allowed our students to incorporate the areas that they were both experts in and then grade those separately based on our individual students' contributions. Because of course, we're working with two very different grading systems that don't entirely match up. Stacey, do you want to go ahead and say more about how we adapted this for Shenandoah?
Yes. The unfortunately blurry picture to the right here are 10 of our 12 students at SU who participated in the project here at Shenandoah. So we were a criminology course, environmental criminology, which really draws from sociology in many ways, environmental sociology with a criminal justice and crime focus. And so for this particular podcast, I was really hoping and aiming for the students to be able to take the phenomenon in the location that the students had selected and sort of look at the literature around what that physical phenomena will mean for the people living in the region and the social sort of situation within the region. You know, we had a lot of different regions that students focused on among the six groups we had. We had Western Australia, for example, India, the Canadian Arctic, Pacific Island nations, Arabian Gulf, and Western Australia. I think I said that one already. I'm missing one. But you can see that there were really diverse locations that we were working on. And so, you know, there's many sort of extreme weather events and other climate change phenomena that the students learned about within that. We each had our own learning outcomes. I'm going to share the SU ones. Sammy had hers as well. But we basically, these were the ones that were specific to my students, and some of them were shared. So we wanted them to be able to communicate through the podcast to a lay audience. This was really, really important. And I think this is really important, particularly in an undergraduate education. You know, they're learning something very specific. You know, they're really getting ready for future careers. But they're going to be, you know, in a job interview or in some other context, wanting to share with somebody who's outside their field of study, something about what they've done. So we were sort of trying to prepare them a bit for, you know, you've become an expert on something that's very specific, but can you talk to a lay audience about it? So we really wanted the podcast to be accessible. And that's a learning outcome that was shared across both classes. And similarly, the second one was also shared about trying to sort of take the research that they had looked at for the podcast and in the class in general, and try to pick up on the key pieces. So, you know, often looking at very technical literature and saying, okay, how can I translate this? Or what's the key piece for the lay audience? And how can I weave it into this podcast narrative? We also, you know, wanted to have the students work with others and sort of work through the teamwork challenges that can come up to do that virtually. And then also use best practices in narrating a podcast. And so what was a little bit different is the second learning outcome, where it was the research articles or reports. I was really looking, even though the final product that I would receive as the individual professor had the physical climate change aspects to it, I was really grading my students on the contribution of the social legal part. That's sort of how the assessment run, but they're also getting points for a lot of the more general stuff around creating the narrative. So, and so on. And you can see here to the right, this was the textbook that my students were reading to support their learning, a textbook that they utilized in working with Sammy's students, but that Sammy's students did not read necessarily, right? So just to sort of show how we could be learning from this particular book and doing this joint assignment, even if the Cardiff students had a different texts that they were working from. This is a kind of an ugly slide, but here is a rubric that I used for the podcast that was adapted from the one that Sammy was using, right? And so I just sort of tweaked these categories for my class's content, but really the main buckets were similar to the rubric that Sammy's class used. And you can see here that I'm giving most of the points to the third bucket of the 70 points, which were these criminological concepts the students were bringing to bear. But yet, you know, there was a lot of other more general things that they were getting points for, including creativity, including the clarity of their communication, and so on. We also, to help the students, made them aware of a really cool New York Times article that gave a step-by-step guide to how to make your own podcast, and we're on hand to sort of talk and share with the ways to do it. Now, our students, for the most part, if they're at the traditional college age, are digital natives. And so they often know better than us sort of how they want to do this. So if you think about this from the student point of view, and we'll get Greg's point of view in a second on how this worked, they were asked to put together something that had a coherent narrative. It was 12 minutes long. And that had all the voices of their team in it. But the team, of course, is in at least two different places, if not more, cooperating. And so they often used Zoom recording to do this. There were other software that they used as well to make this happen. And so you can see here, so one of the podcasts that our students did, again, we had six in the COIL, but one of them was on the Canadian Arctic. And you can see here the students that participated in that one. And I'm going to turn it over to Greg for a couple minutes to describe, if he wouldn't mind, a little bit about how your team approached doing this and just sort of any impressions you had about it. So Greg, take it away.
Yeah, hi, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So yeah, my name is Greg. Just a little bit of background information on me. I'm a senior here at Shando University. I'm an environmental studies major with a minor in geography. I'd actually never taken a criminology class until this one, so it was a really cool experience. So a little bit about this project. I mean, it's great working with the Sammy's class from Cardiff. So it's pretty interesting. Kind of the Cardiff students were more the environmental experts for us when we put together this project, and then for us, we're focusing more on the legal side. And so that was a really cool experience. I mean, it was really fun to just go really in depth into a topic that we're all kind of passionate about. Going into it, I didn't really know much about what was going on up in the Arctic. And so my path kind of took me towards the geopolitical things that are going on in the Canadian Arctic, with the Arctic Sea Passage up there, with the Northwest Passage and the new Northern Strait that's being developed. And so it was a really fun experience working with the people from Cardiff. And so
great. Greg, did you guys use Zoom? What was your process, technologically, and also just did you have any struggles sort of convening the group to plan what you were doing? Anything like that?
Yeah, so I was fortunate to have a really good group. And we used Facebook Messenger. We made a group chat on there. I know some other groups did Snapchat group chats, or just did text message group chats. And then we would get together on Zoom. We would plan it usually about 1 or 2 days a week that we get together. So,
okay, great. So it sounded like you had some really good experiences. It was pretty smooth sailing. Sammy and I are going to talk a little bit about the challenges towards the end. In the interest of time, Eunice, do we want to listen to a minute of the podcast, or shall we just move forward? It's really...
Yeah, I think, definitely. We're thinking around maybe 10, 20 Eastern time. We can open up for questions. So it's up to you, but it might be nice to hear a minute or so.
So we'll listen to the first minute or so of the podcast. So Greg, I think your part is sort of at the end, so you won't have to have the uncomfortable experience of listening to yourself, which can be a little strange sometimes. Here we go. Hopefully we can hear this. It's not working. Sorry. I tested it earlier and it worked. Let's see what I can do here. Oh, I know what the problem is, I think. Okay.
Yeah, I think also share your screen with audio might help.
Oh, okay.
And as we're, Stacey, you're working through that, folks are welcome to ask questions in the chat. And we already have one question that maybe Sammy and Stacey could address later on is, did the classes meet synchronously? And or was it primary asynchronous, synchronous, or a combination? That was a question that emerged in the chat. And folks are also welcome to write other things there as well.
Maybe I could come in on that question while Stacey is dealing with the technical side, so a bit of time later. We had a combination of synchronous and asynchronous. So we had three synchronous activities planned as a whole COIL group. So we had an icebreaker activity, we had the in-class activity where we presented to each other, where I showed that photo, and then we had a wrap-up activity where we kind of discussed our feelings around the project and talked about each other's podcasts. Beyond that, everything was asynchronous, but also the students, of course, organised their own group meetings as well to complete the assessment. How are we doing with the podcast, Stacey?
I think it might work. Let's see. Can people hear that?
Hello and welcome to our podcast, Earth Day Every Day.
I'm Izzy Evans.
And I'm Rory Bateson.
And today we're talking about all things chilly, looking into the Canadian Arctic region, how it's changing at an alarming rate, and what this means for social and legal aspects.
Helping out with our journey into the Arctic, we are various specialists, including ourselves, who dedicate the research to this vast Arctic region. Introducing Rose Farr.
Hi, I'm excited to be here. Tara Cheatham.
Hey guys, it's great to be speaking with you.
And Greg Van Steen.
Hey guys, thanks for having me.
And Carly Christensen.
Hi guys, thanks for having me.
Great to have you all here.
Now Rose, mine and your research is very closely linked to what we both look into. How the Canadian Arctic is going to change and adapt as we move into the future. But could you just give us a brief description of the region and set the scene before we dive into the main topics for discussion?
Of course. So the Canadian Arctic is an important location to look at when discussing climate change due to its unique environment. With snow making up 80% of the precipitation annually, in Canada, the Arctic makes up 40% of the total land mass, which is underlaid by a layer of permafrost. This is ground that has been frozen for 2 years or longer. However, due to climate change, the permafrost has been melting.
So why should we be worried about this?
The reason for my concern is because the environment is very fragile and susceptible to the impacts of climate change. Observed levels of snow precipitation have already decreased, and on average, Canada's annual average temperature has warmed an estimated 1.7 degrees Celsius.
Okay, so that gives you just a little bit of the flavor. Many of the students had a little jingle, you know, beforehand, like this group. And in one of the podcasts on the Pacific Island Nations, there was some role playing. So we had folks who were embodying the director of an NGO, and then somebody else was a big CEO of a solar panel company, right? That was trying to do something in just, you know, good for the environment, but with a sort of industrial focus, which was really interesting. So we have some other sort of student feedback that we captured along the way after the project was over. So I'm gonna share that really quickly. So we used Mentimeter. I don't know if folks have used this before, but it's a polling, it's free polling software that you can use in education. And let's see, try to share my screen again. Okay, so at the very end, so we had a synchronous meeting at the very, very end. So what happened was we said to the students, they'd already turned in their podcasts to the Google site, classroom site. They were able to listen to others, but we said, please listen to at least one other podcast that wasn't the one you made, and be ready to talk about it. And so we went through each podcast and had an open discussion, and students commented on each other's. But at the end, we said, you know, how would you describe this whole experience in one word? And this is what we got. So a little bit of a word cloud here. Sammy, did you want to maybe give some impressions of the word cloud?
Yeah, sure. So one thing I should say is with Mentimeter, if a word comes up several times, it makes it bigger. So our kind of three key takeaways here were fun and interesting, which were great, but also stressful. And I think that's a reflection of one of the main challenges that Stacey and I faced in completing this project was that we had classes of two different sizes. My class had about 70 students and Stacey had nearer 17. So in discussions with John and Veronica, it became very clear that obviously all of my students couldn't take part in the COIL because the groups would just be so overwhelmingly Cardiff-based. So we decided to make the COIL opt-in for my students, but then it was compulsory for all of Stacey's students. So while that was great that my students got a choice, and those who didn't participate in the COIL still did the podcast assignment, just without the kind of social and legal aspects. So they had a very similar experience and they could still participate in the teaching each other activity we did. So they didn't miss out entirely. But it did, of course, mean that the kind of students from my class who opted into the COIL were generally my most motivated students and those who are very much kind of targeting the best grades. And they're also in their final year at university. They're about to graduate. And the way the system works in the UK is that how your grades contribute to your overall degree classification, the third year is weighted much more heavily than the second year and the first year. So I think that meant that my students did experience some level of stress just because they were dealing with Shenandoah students who had lots of different motivations. So in most cases, I think this worked out absolutely fine, but it probably meant that mine were a little bit more concerned about deadlines and were worried when things didn't initially go perfect. But in that case, like, because I think Stacey and I had lots of time to establish the relationship and we've gone through this training, it's actually something that as soon as the students would come to me and say, oh, we're concerned because we haven't heard from Shenandoah in a few days, that I could just email Stacey and be like, hey, you want to check in with your students? And I think we managed in most cases to do a fairly good job of keeping everyone on track. And I noticed a question from Vittor in the chat around exactly this. So this is probably answering that. I don't know if you wanted to add anything, Stacey, on your end, in terms of you probably had a much more difficult task in terms of your students were told they had to do this rather than opting in like mine.
Yeah, I think my students definitely rose to the challenge, no doubt. And, you know, shout out to Greg for really just, you know, being one of those students that really took this opportunity and ran with it so excellently. And, you know, but it was, we had freshmen to seniors in the class. It was only 12 students. And for various reasons, it didn't go through the normal registration process. So it was actually available to our students a little bit later than usual. So that may have also affected, you know, who signed up and so on. And so it really was the Shenandoah students, it seemed, were a little bit chiller on when they were going to get started on things, waited a little longer than maybe Sammy's students. You know, I think Sammy's students were ready to pace themselves through. And I think my students were thinking, well, we've got 4 or 5 weeks, so, you know, I'll get to this, you know, in a couple of weeks or something. And those are just different, you know, institutional cultures, different student cultures that we're dealing with. But to sort of help the students meet each other in the middle was a lot of what I ended up doing on my end. And I think similarly, Sammy, you know, there was a middle place there that they could meet. And that's what we needed to do. And it wasn't something that we really had, you know, you can't anticipate everything. And we just hadn't talked about that possibility. It didn't, you know, didn't necessarily come up. I think a lot of what we expected was that the British students would be quieter culturally, like less likely to warm up, and the Shenandoah students would be chattier or something. I don't even think that really happened. I felt, you know, you can't anticipate everything. And so you need to be ready with your partner, your professor, the other professor to really just, you know, I remember the morning I woke up and I got the emails that my students, some of them were not on board quite yet with getting some stuff done, and feeling like, oh no, it's all over. Like it's, and just being like, no, it isn't, you know, everything's going to be fine. You can do this. You know, and I had the training, and, you know, every COIL trainer will tell you there's always that moment where things seem like they're falling apart and you're like, oh no, are the students going to do these things? And it's fine, you know, just with the little reorganization and some coaxing, you know, everything more or less got back on track. I think one of the challenges that I face as an instructor, and one of the things that I would do very differently next time, and as it was happening, I was like, I can't believe I didn't think of it this way. I think I had my students doing too much learning about environmental criminology itself while they were then also cooperating with the Cardiff students. So I showed you that textbook. We had only gotten through at that point, because there was other learning before we were reading that book in the course. We had only gotten through a couple chapters of the book before they started the cooperation with Shenandoah. And so having students learn the sort of course content and do this really big project that involved, you know, international cooperation and software and editing and writing a podcast script. I think that in the future, you know, I need to really front load, at least for my class, a lot of the material so that they can really focus more on the podcast production itself. So that was a big learning for me. You know, it looks like Sammy and I may be able to do this again in 2024, potentially. And I almost can't wait because I think, based on this experience, my second time around would be a better experience for the students probably. But again, so I think the stressful part, you know, was definitely there. The challenge was definitely there. And as a professor, you're sort of constantly sort of in this fulcrum of, you know, I need to push the students a little. That's part of the learning process. Maybe it'll be a little uncomfortable, but it can't be too uncomfortable, right? It can't be impossible to reach for. And so that continues to be when you do something really innovative that the students may have never done before, that you've never done before, you're kind of on that edge of acceptable challenge, I'll put that in quotes. And so I got to play with that edge a little bit, and so did my students. Yeah. Sammy, did you want to add any challenges before we wrap up?
I think maybe we should leave time for questions, but I think just to, I saw in the chat as you were talking about kind of being at the point where you think, oh, is it all going to fall apart? A couple of people have said yes, been there, me too. we kind of were almost waiting because it went so perfectly to start with. We knew something would kind of go wrong. And when we're talking about something going wrong, I mean, this was really only almost a few days of us being like, okay, we need to reassess. And we very quickly got the students back on track, and having spoken to mine since, even the ones who had a more challenging time and getting their US partners to engage have still told me, oh, it's my favorite module of the year. I really enjoyed it. I've taken a lot away from this. I've spoken to them about, even if it was challenging, then think about in the future when you're having a job interview and you have to describe working in a team, you can use all these examples because you did that, you had the challenges, you got through it, and you still got an excellent grade at the end. But Eunice, did we want to go to questions before we wrap up?
Yeah, first off, I want to say, wow, I'm really super impressed. This was amazing. I'm speechless in many ways. So maybe we can give a round of applause to both Sammy and Stacy for their virtual projects. So many things that really impressed me there. The first thing was being open about what worked well and what didn't. And you know, learning from the successes and failures. Really appreciate you sharing that. Also, the Medium podcast is fascinating because most of our coils at Shando are videos or joint presentations using slides. So I'm really happy to see this Medium used. The podcast, they sound like from the BBC almost when I was listening to them. So I hope others can explore that Medium. And I love the point about accessibility, you know, making the podcast accessible. And we really emphasize that here at Shenandoah as well, like making sure students have the necessary skills when they go into the job and workforce, and being able to explain what they've learned in their classes to their peers. And lastly, the kind of interdisciplinary nature, as you both noted, the idea of a criminologist professor working with someone in climate change and then producing this unique medium and product is remarkable. So yeah, so we have a couple of minutes for questions. I would encourage people to ask them in the chat, and if they feel comfortable, they can unmute themselves and ask. I saw one question, Sammy, this kind of builds off what you were mentioning about the synchronous. So were the synchronous during your class period, or did you have to make special sessions for that?
It was a combination of the two. So they were at any time in one of our classes, because we couldn't quite get classes that were at exactly the same time because it's a 5-hour difference. So we always had either it was during a Shenandoah class and my students stayed a bit later in the evening, or the Shenandoah students had to do something first thing in the morning while my students were physically in class in Cardiff. So we made it equal, but it wasn't too horrendous time difference for anyone, I didn't think.
Yeah, and we only had 3 synchronous meetings. And then in addition, because we were each able to travel to each other's campus, Sammy and I, we also each had an in-person session with the students as well. So,
all right, great. And there was a question about sharing your course assignment from Laura. So maybe we could include that in the email. We have everyone's email address. We'll send you email maybe with these slides, and we'll clean up that podcast as Stacy was mentioning, and we can share that as well in the future. So great. Other thoughts or questions? And then John, if anyone has broader questions about the Transformation Lab Institute, please feel free to reach out to us at global@aacnu.org.
Thanks, Eunice. I always try not to take the floor in these situations, but this time I'm very curious. Greg, since you're with us here from a student perspective, I'd be curious to hear how you think this group project really compared to other types of group projects you've done within Shenandoah context or other times in your academic career.
Yeah, this is definitely one of the most fun and interesting projects I did. I mean, getting to not only work, but, you know, just communicate and just like get that experience of connecting with other people around the world. It was, you know, it was a very cool experience. one of my other classes last semester, we actually did another COIL project too with students from Malaysia. And so that was a little bit challenging because Cardiff is only a 5-hour difference, but over there it was a 12-hour difference. So that presented some challenges, just the meeting times and stuff, but both projects were great. Something just very unique, and it's really not that challenging to do. I mean, it's just a lot of us, like a lot of it's just on us as students to just be disciplined and you know, be professionals and accommodate to each other's times and stuff. So it builds really good skills in a world where we're going to, we're probably going to go into fields where we're connected even more globally.
All right, wonderful. Thanks so much, Greg. I'm really happy to hear the student voice as part of this forum. So I want to invite Maria, if you have any final reflections, and then we'll turn it over to Stacey and Sammy to conclude. So.
I just want to say how, you know, when you start off with an idea and you don't know how things are going to turn out, and how fantastic it is to hear from Stacey and Sammy about the actual experience of doing this course, and to also know from Greg that, you know, it was fun and it was cool, and I love the word cloud. I actually, this has sort of opened up all kinds of things I'd love to quiz Sammy and Stacey about at a later date when we're thinking about the next competition. But as I said in the chat, you know, we do plan to launch another cohort later on in the year. So please do keep an eye on that and on our website. That will be announced there, or you know, you actually we can get your emails from Eunice to if you're interested in us letting you know. But I, you know, I really do, from our perspective at Fulbright, this is something that is absolutely central to our strategic imperatives, because of it really offering this international dialogue to lots more people, and to bringing together these different kinds of collaborations of which we've heard so many described just in this hour, right? And to bring attention in new and different ways to these big problems like climate change. So thank you so much, Sammy and Stacey. Thank you, John and Veronica, for the amazing work. Thank you, Eunice, and to my colleagues on the call, Jessica and Rebecca also, who've worked super hard on this, and someone who's not here at the moment, but Sam also worked, the other program manager. Rebecca is the program assistant alongside Jessica, program manager. So my apologies, I've got to run, but thank you for this session. It was really terrific.
Thanks so much, Maria. I'm so happy to hear that COIL is part of the strategic plan of Fulbright. So yeah, final words to Sammy and Stacey. Anything you want to leave us with before we conclude?
No, I think I feel like Maria had a really nice sort of ending, tied up in a bow of it. So it's hard to follow that. But no, it's been a real honor to be selected to do this work. I can't say enough about how it really helped my pedagogy in a general sense, not just around COIL, but, you know, how to engage students, how to, you know, I've been teaching for 20 years. It's easy to get into your sort of routine and you kind of do your thing. And I feel like I have a new lease on teaching, because I'm doing more creative things, you know, a little bit later in my career. And so I feel like I'm refreshed. So that's, I think Fulbright and ACE and AACNU for that. And Sammy for teaching me a lot of things too.
Oh, vice versa. And yeah, I think I would just wrap up by saying, yes, we've been quite honest today about kind of the details of the process and maybe some of the challenges we face, but which is important, especially in the hope that Fulbright will kind of fund these kind of things again, because we want other people to be able to build on what we've done. But I think Stacey and I have both learned so much from this that, as we said, we're excited to do this again. Now we've done it once, there's so many things that we would change to do it better next time, that I'm really looking forward to the chance to do more things like this and, yeah, learn more about COIL going forward.
And anecdotally, I'm so sorry to pipe in at the last minute. I've been listening the entire time. I was in a veterinary hospital, and all the vets just happened to eavesdrop on what the heck I was listening to. And they got interested and started asking me a bunch of questions about what is this virtual exchange coil. So it was quite amusing, and I was trying to get out so I can actually participate. But the irony behind it is that they were intrigued by this whole conversation. So maybe we'll get some more awards set up for folks in the veterinary medical field from this event. So thank you for showcasing. And Greg, it's great to see you. I got the chance to stop in November, right before Thanksgiving U.S. holiday, to Stacy's class, and got to see them in motion. And I just wanted to say again, in a very informal way, you know, it's, you know, we strive for perfection so much in everything we do that we lose often the in post-reflection, we realize that maybe things happen for a reason, right? Maybe the fact that you had to do an unusual enrollment period, so you got maybe not the usual suspect students, those kinds of things, you know, in my mind, even more validate this work, because you reached for maybe students that you wouldn't have otherwise reached if you had recruited in a normal time, right? And that's the whole vision, is that we do get exposure to other students who may have never thought about Fulbright. And this also peppers them to think about, you know, also applying at the student level for a Fulbright opportunity. So just again, think of that unusual things happen for a reason, and maybe to the benefit, the greater benefit. So thanks again for all of your efforts. It's been wonderful.
Yeah, thanks so much, Veronica, for chiming in there. And Veronica's been a leader in this project, and want to once again thank everyone for joining this forum, and in particular the various partnerships that made this happen. So maybe we can give a round of applause to everyone before we conclude. Thanks so much once again, and we look forward to being in touch. All right, goodbye.